Sean Burton, your host of the Swole Podcast, swolepodcast.com. Soon to be the best fucking podcast underneath the Joe Rogan podcast, because I don't think anybody can top that shit. What's going on, everybody? Thursday, picked up a couple of snacks on my way to the gym. Usually get a piece of fruit and a protein bar or a pack of peanuts or something like that. And everything I need before I drive up there and actually take my pre-workout down at the bar. Real quick, I had a really interesting conversation, or I guess a short text with a former client of mine about me. I've always had this issue where I give off this image that's never true to life. And every time I meet somebody, they gather an assumption before they ever even talk to me, or they try to go in with an open mind, and then I talk about something, and then they kind of start sticking to that particular subject, but then I switch gears on them real fast, and then they can't understand how I do that. So basically, for example, when I was in high school, I took Latin for 3 years. I was junior classical league and my junior year of high school. Whoop-de-fucking-do. Anyways, I remember being in the gym and when I was working there, and this lady who actually taught Latin on a university level was in there, and she was talking to one of the other trainers, and I overheard it, and I said, "Oh yeah, I took Latin in high school." And she just kind of looked at me, and I said, "What? I did. I was, you know, whatever." And she said, "Who was your teacher?" And da 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 da. And I told her, and she actually remembered my teacher. And she was like, "Oh wow!" And then I actually spoke to her in Latin, a little bit of Latin from what I could remember. And she just had this blank look on her face. So immediately that just told me that she thought I was bullshitting, number one, and number two, she didn't really expect me to, you know, throw that on her. And not too long after that, I was having an evaluation with my boss at the time, and he basically told me, "Look, you know, you're a great trainer, but the problem is that you're not approachable." And I said, "What do you mean?" And he said, "Well, you know, you look intimidating with your bald head and your goatee and your tattoos, and you wear your beanie around here, and this is when I wore earrings, so I get your earrings in, you know, nobody's gonna approach you." And I said, "The fact that you're even bringing this up really, really pisses me off, to be honest. But you know what? He's right. He's very right. I have a very, I have this very strong, aggressive appearance. I don't know how to change that. I don't even know if I would even want to fucking change that, to be honest. But it just kind of, and I talk to people a lot about this when we talk about relationships with other people when they don't work out. So basically, I see this as a filtering process. I see this as I have this aggressive, intimidating demeanor, which is not true to me. Anybody who is not worth my time, or anybody who I would not want in my life, is gonna see that and is gonna think, "All right, never mind," and then move on. It saves me a lot of bullshit. It saves me a lot of bullshit later on down the line, which is what I mean by a filtration. It's a filter process, a filtration process, excuse me. I mentioned this before with a friend of mine who had a problem finding a guy that would stick around beyond a couple of days, and she's a woman of high quality. She's a very awesome chick. There's nothing wrong with her whatsoever. She looks good. She, you know, she takes care of her health. She's got a damn good job. She's motivated. She's goal oriented. She just went back to school. I mean, she's doing all of this good shit. And she said, "You know, the moment I really start opening up to a guy is the moment he takes off." And I said, "Look, this is part of your natural filter. I mean, if you start becoming raw And then the guy is like, oh, fuck this, I'm out. I mean, it's a natural deterrent, and it's good. It's good for, you know, it's good for you. It's good for your soul. It's good for everything. It saves you a bunch of bullshit. So, I mean, is it annoying as fuck? Yes. And I'm in no way, shape, or form comparing myself to this level. But it reminds me of... It reminds me of these people who are incredibly beautiful. These women who are incredibly beautiful and come off as intimidating to men. Or these women who are incredibly built. Like, they're built up, they're strong, they look great, and they come off as intimidating to other men. And vice versa to other women or whatever the fuck you're into nowadays. And it's fucking annoying because it's like people don't even really take the time or even put the effort into get beyond that physical barrier, that physical looks barrier, because they just kind of take it as, okay, well, that's obviously, you know, that's way out of my league, or no, that's not something I would be interested in, or I don't think I can handle that, or whatever. And it just kind of goes to show you that, you know, it's a bastard, but again, you know, if it saves me or them or us or whatever, if it saves a bunch of bullshit later on down the line, then I actually think it's worth it. I think it's worth having this. I think it's actually beneficial having this. You just have to, you know, you have to deal with it and just chalk it up to, all right, well, you know, one more down and see who else comes around. But anyways, that's my thought for the, that's my pre-workout thought. Just got to the gym, so we're going to, what are we doing today? Push days, lighter push day. So a lot of bench, a lot of shoulder press, a lot of log pressing, a lot of good stuff. My shoulders are still fucked, but it really doesn't matter at this point. I'm gonna do it anyway. So check out that commentary. Hopefully you learned something, you greedy bastards, and stay tuned for an afterthought if you stick around for the entire training.
I'm quite the charming character, aren't I? Oh man. All right. So Thursday, light session coming in. We have some bench press. We have some, yeah, there's Trent down in the gym again. Came in to work on his deadlifts after the previous video. Apparently didn't like what he saw, so he came in and he was going to go over it again. He had to take off. He had to take off suddenly because his little one got a little sick, so they went in and took him to the doctor. Anyways, pre-workout, that was really hard to take down. It was real thick, and I need a new pre-workout. I think right now it's... I can't remember the name. One of Gat's pre-workouts, the big one. It's not the concentrated one. That and some amino acids. Just typical pre-workout stuff. I can't remember who I'm texting, but hey, who cares? Anyway, so Thursday down at the bar, San Angelo, Texas. Thursday, as they like to call it. We actually all wear the same shirt today, and that was kind of weird. I don't even know how that happened, but me, Trent, and Tommy all ended up wearing the same shirt, if I could speak today. Shout out to Hamilton Bulldogs hockey team up north. I think that hoodie cost me $2 up in Canada when I was there. It's one of my favorite hoodies. Ironically, I'm actually wearing it today while I'm doing some commentary for you folks. First video, I apologize, was a little long. Hour is a long time to kind of sit in front of your computer and watch workout commentary videos, so I apologize for that. I'm going to try to keep these to about 45 minutes max, and ironically this one is about 45 minutes max, so we're going to try it out and see how it works. Right here I'm just telling Trent, he had a couple of questions about his deadlift and how he could improve it. Trent went so long without using straps that now that he's using them, he's basically trying to assimilate himself with that, and it's amazing how much more he can focus on utilizing his legs in the deadlift without having to worry about gripping it so much. Even though you can use all the chalk you want, you can alternate your grip, etc., hook grip if you're into weightlifting, but there's just, once you're that hooked and you're that secure in the bar, I mean, you're just, your whole body, I feel your whole body can activate, you know, so much more, because your body is only as strong as your weakest point. So shout out to that cell phone wallet. That's seriously the best fucking thing I ever bought. Amazon, I fucking love you so much. Cell phone wallets make my life so much easier. Yeah, check me out, grinning bastard. I don't even know. Who the fuck are you texting? You're supposed to be training. What the fuck are you doing, guy? Anyways, so on the agenda today, like I said, light press, working over bench press again, some light chest exercises, and some light push. Really focusing on utilizing the log. Now, I only got a little bit of log training footage simply because I didn't think of testing the angle of the camera in the actual position, so I kind of screwed myself over on that, but... so there's a little bit of log footage. If your gym does not have a log, I strongly suggest you talk to somebody about getting it. It's so different from the push press, even though it's the same muscle activity, same muscle activation. It's the awkward position that the log puts you in. And this gym has two of them. It has a big one and a small one. I frequently like to use the bigger one simply because it puts me in an even more awkward position, if that even makes sense. It really forces me to focus on foot position and body position, and it's so much different than the bar. Plus, it's in neutral hand position. It's a lot easier on my shoulder, and I feel it. The log press turns into a more of a full body activation because I actually have to pick it up off the ground and swing it up. And seeing as how I'm much more interested in strongmen than I am in anything else. It's just more relevant to me. And another benefit of having the log was we would do log press for chest, because it puts your hands at that neutral position, and it just changes your routine up so much. So the more you change your routine up, I feel the more beneficial, the more benefit you got going on. All right, so we're pulling out the bands here. These bands have made a huge difference in my recovery and my flexibility and my mobility process. I never got into bands until I started watching Kelly Starter videos on YouTube. Fucking amazing individual, great, very interesting guy. His the way he explains things is just, it's so easy to understand. Even though he can get real technical on your ass, he keeps it very, he speaks to his audience in a language that his audience understands. So I have epic amounts of respect for him. Here, just trying to open up that chest. My left shoulder is a bitch. I had, as you'll hear later on, I have a huge golf ball size knot in my left trap. On top of that, a couple of knots in my chest, going from the sternum out to the glenohumeral process. So it's a bit of a pain in the ass. Ooh, he's stretching now. Look at that. Look at the flexibility on my big ass. Goodness gracious. Yeah, you don't see flexibility like that. I think I tried to change the angle because you just see my big ass right there, and that's just not, no, thumbs down, bro. That's not attractive at all. Get your big ass back there. These shorts, I've had, it's so funny seeing these. So I slit the sides of these shorts, because at the time I was wearing nothing but Under Armour. There you go. Yeah, back your big ass up. I was wearing nothing but Under Armour for the longest time because it was part of my work uniform in San Antonio. And a buddy of mine at the time was like, yeah, man, you gotta get the sliding shorts. It makes, makes everything so much better. Well, the fucking sliding shorts were expensive as hell. So I thought, fuck that. I bought some HDFU compression shorts with the little slit on the side. Compound shorts with the little slit on the side. And I was like, holy shit, this is awesome. So then I went through this period where I was just slitting all the sides of my shorts. Now it kind of looks almost like a skirt, almost like a kilt, but not really. But gives me a lot of leg freedom, so fuck it. It works for me. And I'm not going to pay a shitload of money for pre-slit shorts when I can do this shit myself. So, hey, what am I doing, So Tommy's hanging out in the background. He's talking to us about him changing up his... training routine. Tommy's still a competitive powerlifter, powerlifting coach, head coach of Barbarian Powerlifting down here at the bar, and just all around good guy. You clearly can't go wrong. The dude has more knowledge than he fucking knows what to do with, and he has a tendency to speak to us in a way that we have a hard time understanding. So if you ever get a chance to meet Tommy, if he starts getting into his technical jargon, you gotta cut him off, or otherwise he's just gonna go fucking forever. Yeah, just see, I can see that slit right there, and I can't tell you how much shit that I've gotten from everybody about cutting my shorts, but I've, you know, this is me, and this is what I do. Nice little calf tattoo there, bro. that was, I was a human canvas for an apprentice in San Antonio when I was there, and I figured, yeah, why not? I'm gonna get a calf tattoo, why not? I want more. I need to find a better... Yeah, find a good tattoo artist around here. I got so many tattoo ideas. And not like I have the money for it, but still, fuck it. I still want to... If anyone's looking for a human canvas, I can be your human canvas. I can definitely do that. Yeah, look at those chucks. Some of those chucks are faded. I don't even know how long I've had those things. But honestly, some of the better training shoes that I've had, my Chuck Taylors, my Adidas Sambas, if I don't go just straight sock barefooted, I have incredibly flat feet, and it always worked well for me. It doesn't really work well for everybody, but you know, it all comes down to personal preference. You know, your footing, your footwear, they talk about it a lot. It's the most important part of your grounding to establish your kinetic chain. If you're, I say that because I can't understand how people can work out in running shoes, the most unstable shoes in the world, because your body just cannot fire off the way that it needs to in the most unstable of environments. It's just like, you know, fucking doing squats on Bosu balls and whatnot. Like, you know, it's great, it's fantastic, it's great, but your body can't fire off because it doesn't have a strong, sturdy, stable ground to fire off on. You know, it's just like this. It's just like grounding electricity. You can't get a strong connection if your ground is shit. And the same way with the body, your body is compromised of an entire central nervous system that are all fired off on electricity. Your body is energy. Now, you cannot fire off at 100% if you are not stable, and you're weakening your power output. And studies have actually shown that there is more core activation and power output on sturdy ground than there is on an unstable, unsturdy ground. Little research for you. Boom. You know, athletic training, athletic conditioning, you know, when it comes to sport-specific training, is going to be different. Keep that in mind. Sport-specific training is going to be very, very different than just regular conditioning work. Where this is all weight training, conditioning work, you have to be sturdy, you have to be stable, and you have to be rock solid. You have to be solid on the ground. That's the only way you're going to fire off. What do we got? Oh, we're foam rolling again. Hooray! How many times can a man foam roll in one day? Probably not enough. Two, boy, we're going to start adding some cardio. We're going to start adding some cardio to your session, son. Look at you, you big ass. But yeah, this one part here, most people will complain about back pain, especially if you have a position where you're sitting a lot throughout the day. So if you're sitting a lot throughout the day, and you're going to develop some sort of back pain. And the first thing everyone says is, oh, my back hurts, oh, my back hurts. But in reality, your glutes are tight. That's the problem. It's not the fact that your back hurts. It's the fact that your glutes are so fucking tight. And if it's not your glutes, it's your IT band. You know, and it's a lot of people have this false idea. Can't talk today. That, you know, oh, it must be my back pain, and, you know, I shouldn't work out, I shouldn't do this, I shouldn't do that because I have back pain. And in reality, the reality of the situation is that you have back pain because you are not stretching, because you are not flexible, and because you are not working out. In almost 8 years of personal training, I cannot tell you how many times I've been told, oh, I don't do that because of my back. Oh, I don't do this because of my back. And it's, number one, everything that I'm trying to get these people to do is going to help their back. But for some reason, they just have it in their head. And then, you know, they just go on with their day until they finally, I guess it's going to take like a doctor with a PhD to tell them, oh, yeah, you need to work out. And then they finally do it. But then again, not even that. So here we go, doing a little band work to open up that shoulder and open up that chest. This right here, I'm just trying to get that, my, like I said, that chest to open up. This is not my bad shoulder, so I can really get pretty wide on there and get it going on to the bad shoulder. A bit of a decreased range of motion and a lot of strain and a lot of pain in that right there. The line isn't as straight, but I do like to keep that opening up, whether it's stretching out through the bicep or actually in the chest, wherever it happens to be at that particular day. 9 times out of 10, it's all in the chest. Sometimes it's in the bicep, and sometimes it's just my traps are so bound up and so tight that it's just pulling on the shoulder. Here I'm just kind of scoping out Transform, making sure that his back, his lumbar is flat, making sure that his chest is up tall, and it gives him trying to help him get in a position where he can, yeah, really engage his legs and then stand up with it. And the straps just help so fucking much when it comes to that. And the big debate is straps, no straps, whatever. My thought is, you know, at the end of the day, if the world record deadlift holder can use straps, then goddamn it, straps are okay. So I could give a shit less, you know, straps and all that. I actually don't prefer the alternate grip because I feel it puts my body in a pretty bad misalignment. I feel that with that part, my body fires off in different ways on both sides. I know it sounds weird, but that's exactly how I feel. I feel like one side, it starts to the bar starts to turn a little bit on the up, and it becomes more haphazard, more hazardous to my core activation and also my back too. Seeing as how both my legs are two different lengths, I just try to keep that in mind. I try to keep everything as consistent try to keep it as consistent throughout the timing, try to keep it as even as I possibly can. So you got the warm-up going on. Get your fucking phone out of here. God damn, who the fuck could you be texting right now? You're supposed to be training, dude. What the fuck? Me talking to myself. I'm sure every person who's watched this probably saying the same fucking thing. Get the fuck off your phone. No one's gonna want to watch you just hang out on your phone, bud. Yeah, you. And your gum. God damn. What are you doing? Anyways, gearing up with chest days, we really don't focus too much on foam rolling for the back and the rear kinetic chain unless we are working back days as well. Seeing as how we're going just to straight push. Look at them fingers flying. Look at them thumbs flying. God damn, look at you. Hey, texting fast as fuck. Jesus. Anyways, these days we just really focus on a lot of band work and rotator cuff work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I actually recommend that you do all the foam rolling, you do all that. Consistently throughout the day. I was in a bit of a time crunch because we had I had some work to do when I got home, and I didn't really have the hours that I would prefer to come in and do some work. There we go. We're getting an angle of the bench to setting it up. Now this is where it's gonna get this is where it gets good. Interesting. More interesting, more than anything. We have foot placement. We have hand placement, and a way to really, yeah, get that chest up nice and tall and wrapping the thumbs around the bar and really gripping the shit out of the bar. Now, I bring this up for a couple of reasons, the whole gripping the shit out of the bar. And I learned this from Tommy. Tommy has massive biceps. Tommy has massive arms in general. And Tommy doesn't do arms at all. When I've asked him, like, hey, you know, we're always like, how did you get your arms so big? He's always saying, like, oh, well, I bench press and I deadlift, and that's how I get big arms. Now, to a lot of people, that could sound kind of retarded, seeing as how guys with big arms usually do curls of some kind or whatnot. But the way that I feel, the way that I grip that bar, I kind of turn my thumbs down and point and my pinky up a little bit. And I literally squeezed the shit out of the bar. And I feel that the more I squeeze the shit out of the bar, I actually get bicep activation out of it. I was telling Trent this the other day. And it's kind of weird how that happens. It's kind of weird how I got that. But I feel it more and more and more. And ironically, I took a photo of myself and I sent it to one of my friends who's a competitive powerlifter. And even she said, she's like, your biceps look bigger. Your biceps look like they've gotten bigger. And I said, well, I don't do curls, so I don't know how that would be, but it makes, to me now doing it that way, it makes a lot of sense. It makes so much sense. So we need to, that's the way that I do it. I know everyone's going to be different. I used to be a thumb over the bar, suicide grip, type of bencher because it really helped my shoulder. But, that basically turns into just crutching it instead of focusing on the real issue, which is why my shoulder hurts, instead of just trying to work around it. So thumb around the bar, I get a lot more stability out of it, and I think I get a better activation out of it. Right now, as you can tell, I'm doing some, you can't see it, but you can pretty much tell what I'm doing. I'm doing some rotator cuff exercise, trying to get as much blood and activation in this area is humanly possible. The shoulders are always going to be the first one to give out, especially depending on how you bench. Now, if you have a bodybuilder's bench where your elbows are high and the bar is going a little bit higher, you are going to get a wicked impingement from it, especially if you're doing an incline barbell bench press. Elbows are high, bar is high. The more powerlifting style, obviously you tell the bar is lower. Grips usually a little bit closer and the elbows are low. A lot of people do not know, I mean, Tommy and I will have had this discussion so many times. A lot of people don't know how to bench press properly. And when I say properly, I mean actually getting the full activation out of your chest. Now, if you watch like Michael Hearn videos on bench press, if you watch Mark Bell videos on bench press, it's all fairly consistent. The elbows are down and the grip usually comes in a little closer to get a little bit more chest activation. I grip as wide as I do, I guess, because I'm as big as I am. I mean, I can look at myself now and think, Jesus Christ, and I can't tell if I'm just fat or if I'm just big, but I grip wider because it's very comfortable for me. Right here, my index fingers are in the knurling of the bar, which is, you know, Tommy would see it and he would tell me, like, no, man, why the fuck are your fingers, why your grip's too wide? And I said, yeah, but I mean, I've always done that. And it actually feels very comfortable. Sometimes I'll experiment and I'll come in and I'll come out, but I feel like every time I do that, I always end up hurting my shoulder more than anything. Put your fucking phone away. What do we got? 185. 185. Yeah, 185 on the bar. Sticking to, even though I'm going lighter, my rep range is going to be still between 5 to 7. I feel like if I could do more than 8 to 10 reps, I need to go up a little bit in weight, especially if I'm going lighter. Lighter as in weight, not lighter as in repetition. And again, like, it goes down to your goals. If you want to build a lot of muscle, then your rep range is going to be higher. If you want to build an enormous amount of strength, your rep range is going to be lower. I mean, this is all common knowledge. It should be common knowledge by now. But then you have guys who come in the gym who, you know, they're like, I'm going to do, you know, 40, 50 repetitions and I'm going to get swole as fuck. And you're just kind of like, okay, bro. And then they eat like 1200 calories a day. gotta eat big to get big. Eat big to get big. You gotta do what you gotta do. What the fuck am I doing? I have no idea what I'm doing. Probably progress, change, pictures, etc., etc. Who knows? I have no idea what I'm doing. I have no idea what I'm doing right there. Anyways, god damn, man. You spend way too much fucking time. Yeah, put that shit away. Anyways. Getting into it, setting back into it, 185, gonna set in. Now look at the foot placement here. Look at the foot placement going in, and, oh, thanks, guy. little alarm right there. Look at the foot placement going in. We're coming in. Feet are way underneath, me, right underneath the hips, and just kind of pushing that out. Now, these are touching my chest. I know the range of motion is short and sweet, but these are actually touching the chest and going in. Not into that full lockout position, because I want to stay in that sweet spot, because that's always been my sticking point, my trouble point. It's never usually the lockout that gives me shit. It's always it's the bottom. It's getting out of that. It's getting out of the bottom that that really it becomes an issue, and it comes down to my shoulder. My shoulder gives me a bunch of shit. Especially as the weight gets heavier, I feel like even if I start adjusting my grip mid sets, it's when it really starts giving me shit. So I'm trying to stay as consistent as humanly possible. Oh yeah, this now I remember this one. This is because the music fucking sucked at this point in the gym. So I felt it was my duty as an avid lifter in the gym to change the music. I think they were playing I can't remember what they were playing, but all I remember is that it fucking sucks. So. Anyways, get into there. Trent's going right back in. We're going to return as soon as I get this music change going on. Yeah, Trent, go ahead. Do your thing. 225, again, sticking to the same modality and focusing on getting our elbows inside and just kind of working the motion and setting her up. Now, the best thing that I learned with Tommy was the initial setup in the bar position. Look at Trent's form right there. Perfect. We're going to go back to that, but I saw him setting up. Like, look at that. Just beautiful. Even though it's 135, it's beautiful. It's a fucking beautiful 135 right there. Setting up. Nicely done. Yep, and I'm checking it out too. Yeah, nicely done. You can't beat that. You can't beat that. It's good quad activation out of the position of the feet. Initiating with the hips. Again, one more time. Hips through, yeah? I mean, again, even though that it's light, the practice is just absolutely perfect. Alright, here we go. 225. Setting up. Big old chest. Boom. 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 And final descent, pause, boom, nice, very nice. Those pauses, I want to touch on that real quick. Those pauses at the bottom of the movement and in the initial release, that makes a huge difference in your progression with the bench. The progression with your bench, your squat, even your deadlift, throwing a pause in the deadlift in the hardest position makes the biggest difference you can possibly make. From adding that, you and again, this goes down to where your trouble point is. If your trouble point is getting out of the hole in the squat, getting the weight up past your knees in the deadlift, or getting that weight off of your chest, this has done the best for me is adding those pauses. Tommy would even say go as far as allowing the bar to come into your chest and sink with it, and then pop it right back up, just to give you a little bit more of a range in the deficit, a little range. It's not a whole lot, but it's enough. See, we're all wearing the same fucking shirt, me, Trent, Tommy, and everybody. That was really fucking weird, and all in threes too. That's weird. Maybe that's why yesterday was such a crazy day. Anyways, but yeah, adding the pauses down to the bottom have really made a huge difference in the bench press and actually a lot of things in the squats as well. I would have to confirm with some of my other buddies who are big into bench pressing, who are big into powerlifting. They would probably tell me a hell of a lot, but you know, these are the people that you need to surround yourself with. If my bench press is my worst lift. It's always been my worst lift. I've had I have two bad shoulders that definitely don't fucking help, and I haven't done barbell in a really long time. Up until the last year, I never really did barbell bench press because of my shoulders, and it's because I was dumb enough to, you know, separate my shoulder, and then the doctor say, well, you can't do that anymore. So I did it. and I just did not like the progression that I was making as far as my chess development goes. So having met Tommy, and then him to like, yeah, well, if you want to get stronger, you got to start doing this, you got to start doing that, you need to come back to the bench press and you know, and work your body through it. So I was very fortunate to meet him randomly in my hometown. The place where I can't stand to be happens to be the place with, you know, some really great people and a really fucking awesome gym. So what can you do, right? Just got to kind of roll with it. Gearing up 275, I can usually handle this for about 4 or 5 reps. I only get 4 here. I still don't understand this. So I'll touch on it when it comes up, but I don't understand how this particular thing happened. But max effort on bench, I'm probably sitting around 315. Like I said, I know it's nothing fantastic. It's actually a pretty fucking horrible lift, but especially for my weight and whatnot. But I have really shit shoulders, but I do not want to use that as an excuse to not bench press or to not even try to get a stronger bench. At one point in time, my max was 250. At one point when I was just kind of starting to get back into bench press, it was 250, and I remember being so fucking happy that I could bench 250 once. And chalk time, nice. I was so fucking happy that I could bench press 250 one time, and now I'm at 315 for one, and I'm like, yay. When there are people who are like half my weight that can bench that, so fuck it, I'm doing what I can. Alright, so initial setup. We got wrist straps on. We got elbow sleeves. We got wrist straps. Setting your feet up, pushing yourself down into that arch. And that again, that's getting that arch in that bench press. I think I was touching on that earlier and I kind of fell off of it. Getting that arch in that bench press, just got it. It helps so much, and it keeps my shoulders so much safer. So here, touch and up, no problem. Now look at my left shoulder. My left shoulder lags horribly. You see that? It wasn't really known to me until later that I had this huge golf ball size knot. All right, so here comes Trent. I get the fourth one, and for some reason, Trent grabs the bar and pulls it back when I try to get the fifth one. And I don't remember asking for a spot. I don't remember asking for help. I guess Trent just kind of came, thought he was gonna save the day. So thanks, Trent. I appreciate that. You fuck this guy. Fun times. Anyways, so yeah, usually like 275. Again, I remember just being so fucking happy that I could bench 250, and now I'm up to 315, and thank God I'm not a fucking power lifter, because dudes would be fucking murdering me all day long, especially on bench. Max squat is about 500, and my max deadlift 545 the other day. I pulled 585, but that was a really long time ago. So moving on to the lock press. Again, like, you need to see the size of this thing. I couldn't get a frame where I could get the whole thing in. Shout out to USAP out there. See that? I couldn't get a frame with the whole thing in, so this is kind of what I've had to work with. This log is fucking huge. These were custom made from El Paso, I think. And we got it in, so the initial setup, stand up with it. Look at the size of that fucking thing. You know, not me, the fucking log, but yeah, me too. I'm fucking huge. Just a couple of bumper plates on the side. Pulled in. Look at that belly. Belly, belly, belly. Boom. Nice. Now this literally keeping the log upright to where I needed to be and just looking up the entire time. Like the fucking thing is in my throat right there at that point. And just kind of stabilizing it up and whatnot. And just killing it. And I think I get one more here. Yep. Boom! Do you get another one? No! I get another one! Dude, grinder. And we set her down. Boom! Right there. Yeah, that sucked. Oh, yep, stars.
What's up? What's happening? What's happening? Going behind the slowest fucking driver in this goddamn town. Nice suburban there, guy. Anyways. Sean Burden, your host of the Swole Podcast, all that cool shit. Anyways, just finished up over at the gym. Took a little while. It's a bit of a struggle. It's one of those days where, you know, shit's just not going right. It's not going as smoothly as I had hoped. And my shoulder is just fucking killing me. And I found out why, because I got a fucking golf ball size knot in my traps. That's why, on my left trap. You'll see in my bench, it suffered a lot because of that. But that's neither here nor there. I was talking with Tommy and just trying to put in perspective one of the major differences between, you know, competitive athletes and trainers, because he's having a bit of issues with a couple of people. And then I realized that it all comes down to the love of this lifestyle, the love of going to the gym, the love of being in the gym. And you know, anybody who is really hardcore into the lifestyle can sympathize, unless you're, you know, on the likes of some other people that I've met who really don't care, because they don't want somebody in the lifestyle. They actually appreciate the break from it. But most people in this lifestyle need people in that lifestyle because they understand it. They understand the benefits of going to the gym, but not only just going to the gym. And this is not like, oh, I'm just going to get on the treadmill for 35 minutes and call it a workout, or I'm going to go do Zumba. This is like, I'm planning my workouts. I'm planning my warm-ups. I am planning my sessions, my sets. I'm planning everything. And I'm allowing myself to be engulfed into this. This is a place where I can just unload all this energy that I have, all of this pent up energy, and it's this massive release. But it's not only that, it literally manifests into this flow like a river, and it starts affecting everything about me. My thoughts become so much clearer, my inspiration becomes much more vivid, my creativity becomes much more abundant, and everything is just heightened to a whole nother level, which is why I can spend, you know, a couple hours in this. And you know, it's I feel that we try to mix and match and we track people who are very opposite, but I've always found that the one thing that I've needed, and the one thing, you know, a lot of people that I've talked to have needed, is that they need somebody who understands this type of lifestyle, understands that we grow so much in the gym. And it's not even about, you know, looking great or six packs or big fucking muscles. It's about this release of pent up energy, and it's about therapy, really what it is. And that was a fucking, regardless of the session not being as good as I had wanted it to be, that was a really fucking good therapy session for myself. So now I'm hungry, but I'm totally cloud free right now, and it allows me to actually do a lot of work. So we're gonna grab some food, grab some stuff for dinner, some meat and veg for dinner, and then we're gonna go to work. It is Thursday. Mark Loeblender podcast drops tomorrow, or really, 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 really late tonight. And I can't wait for you guys to hear it. It's gonna be fucking huge. It's gonna be so fucking good. And see if Mark can. I think Mark's gonna be at the. Mark's probably gonna be at the Arnold. So he's gonna be busy as fuck with that. So we're gonna talk to him later and see what we can make happen. Anyways, cheers, Sean with the Swole Podcast. Stay tuned for the next episode, and hope you enjoyed the video.